this industry in terms of makeup requires a lot of skill. It requires a lot of practice. It requires a lot of your time and your patience to kind of like, you're not going to, like, for example, you're not going to get like a winged liner correct in the first go. It's going to take practice. Your hand has to get steady. You have to have that skill of knowing which part of your eye to lift, which part of your eye, you know, to understand face shapes, to understand what, you know, hooded eyes are, to understand the technique of what should I do to open up an eye, to make an eye look bigger than it is. So yes, there is a lot of technical, there's a lot of skill, which you need to learn. And all this information is available online. There are schools, there are academies, there are wonderful academies in India, there are wonderful academies outside India, you know. So the opportunity to learn is endless. The education is endless. It's just that you have to invest in yourself and try and understand what kind of artist you want to be. Because if you want to be, let's say, a celebrity artist, celebrity makeup artist, you have to be at your A game.
Yes, absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
You don't get, you know, because at the end of the day, you are behind the camera. The actor is in front of the camera. So she, you have, you, your work is represented on her, you know. So you have to be at your A game every single day.
So today it's our 11th episode with Aarti Nair. Let me quickly tell you a brief about Aarti before I add her. So I have picked up this quote from the magazine Vogue, which says, "The relationship between a celebrity and their makeup artist is one that lasts a lifetime." So my my guest is Aarti Nair. She's a celebrity makeup artist. In a career of over 11 plus years as a celebrity makeup artist, she has worked with Sonam, Alia, Pariniti Chopra, Katrina Kaif, Shraddha Kapoor, and many, many more people. She moved to Mumbai to study sociology during her graduation days, but she never left. And today I'm delighted to have her on Cracking the Code. Let's welcome the very talented, a woman who's a true hustler and a powerhouse. Let me welcome Aarti Nair. Hi, Aarti. Good evening.
Hi.
Welcome to Cracking the Code.
Good evening. How's everyone? How are you?
I'm doing good. How about you?
Good. Safe.
So, safe? Okay. So, how's your work from home going on, by the way?
My work from home is actually not, it's not bad, actually. I think I'm making, I'm making the best of the situation. You know, I'm trying to do more digital content. I'm trying to kind of, you know, understand that world, because I think that, you know, earlier we used to shoot so much. I personally didn't have time to kind of, you know, generate content and kind of, you know, give the knowledge that I had gained from so many years of work to my friends and like people who follow me on Instagram, on social media and things like that. So I think that this has given me that time to kind of understand how important it is to give back. And to just share that knowledge that we've gained from so many years.
Let me ask you the first question and let help us understand, because I'm somebody, you know, being a male, I'm somebody who's far away from the makeup and the fashion world, right? So what's the difference between a makeup artist and a celebrity makeup artist, and who exactly is a makeup artist?
I want to say that there is no, like, I feel like you can, you can't, if you're a makeup artist, you are a makeup artist, you know. You can choose to do whichever kind of job that comes to you. I don't think a makeup art, when you become a makeup artist, you say, you know, I will, I mean, it's your choice, you know. You can only work in films, you can only work with celebrities, you can only do bridal, you know, but you can choose, you can only do editorial. The good part about, I think, my career and me choosing this career is that you have a variety of options. You can try everything. You can see what works for you. You can see what works for your kind of makeup that you do. Everyone has a different style of makeup. So if you are someone that loves Hindi films and only wants to work in films, you can do that. There is nothing stopping you from one day saying, I want to do brides or I want to do editorial. You know, you can do anything that you want. You don't have to put yourself in a box and be like, I only will do this and I cannot do anything else. That is not there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can, like, when I started in this line, I didn't start as a makeup artist. And a lot of people know that or don't know that. I don't know. You know, so I started as a stylist because I didn't know anyone in the industry. I didn't know. I didn't know anyone who was working in the industry. So for me, it was like, you know, just I did a makeup course, you know, and then one thing led to another. And you know, because I studied in Xavier, there were so many people who were doing media, who were working in films. I didn't know, you know, you don't really generally ask someone. I mean, I didn't know who was working in which field or whatever, you know. So it was just right. Like somebody knew, a friend of mine who wanted to do films, she knew someone who was in films. He knew somebody who was a stylist. And therefore, from that chain of events is how I got my first job. But I didn't get it as a makeup artist, you know. So that's what. It's your individual choice. It's you. It's your journey and the kind of journey you choose to have. You know, if I was going to be like, no, I don't want to be a stylist. I only want to be a makeup artist. I probably would have to wait till I, you know, got an assistant job or whatever. But because I was already a stylist, I kind of made friends. I met a lot of people. You know, I understood the workings of the industry. And I mean, if you ask me, if I hadn't done the styling part, I wouldn't have met Ria. If I didn't meet Ria, I wouldn't have been able to do Aisha and therefore meet Sonam and therefore through her meet Namrata, and then I became a makeup artist. So there's a whole other saga before me being a makeup artist.
I still want to understand, how do you become a celebrity makeup artist? So is it like a planned thing or how was the journey like? Because you were a sociology student, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. So how did it all happen? Let's talk about your journey.
I'm going to answer this in part. So the first part is I didn't decide, okay, you know what? I want to be a celebrity makeup artist. I wanted to work in films. I was obsessed with films. I was obsessed with filmmaking. I was obsessed with everything that is about a film. You know,
okay.
I grew up watching films with my parents. My father was a huge influence on me watching films, and especially Amitabh Bachchan films and things like that. So for me, that was a great influence. So that stuck with me. Now, because I was not someone who was particularly like, you know, I'm going to go and do my MBA and things like that. I was not, and I think that my mom and both my parents, especially my mom, she knew that. You know, she had that this one is not going to do this, you know. So she sat me down one day and she's like, what do you want to do? And I was like, you know, I want to work in films. Maybe I'll be a director, this, that, whatever. And at that time, she works in advertising, has all her life. And she was working with Farah Khan, the director, choreographer, super talented. They were doing some work together. And my mother is like, listen, I'm going to approach her. She's very sweet. We work really well together. I'm sure she'll be happy to talk. And I was, so literally my first ever introduction into the industry, to anyone who has worked in this industry, was Farah. And I think that she, and to me, I was no one. Like, it's not like we come from a film family or anything like that. You know, she was really open and really happy to sit down with somebody who had a dream, who wanted to work in films, but just didn't know what to do. You know, didn't know where to go, didn't know who to talk to, didn't know how the industry works. So that really, I feel that story will always be with me, because she was so humble and she was so lovely, you know. And talking to her is how I decided that actually my dream and my passion lies in, you know, the styling and the makeup and, you know, putting all of it together. And she told me that, you know, I just finished Om Shanti Om and I worked with Namrata Soni and she's amazing. You need to work with her. And I looked at her and I said, you know what? In my life, I didn't think that, you know, my mom would do a commercial with Farah and, you know, she would be, you know, so sweet to talk to me and give me this kind of guidance. I was like, you know, if it's
right,
I will work in this industry. You have you know, explained and taught me so much in this one conversation. I was like, I'm happy to work hard. And if it's meant to be, I will end up in this industry. And that was our meeting, you know, and that was it. Like, I left. And I did like a 3-month makeup course with Bharat and Doris just to get an idea of how makeup works. You know, what was his school of thought? What was what I was thinking, where I wanted to see myself in like 5-6 years, you know, so all of that. So I did my course, and then after my course, you know, one thing led to the other, like I said in the beginning, and I ended up being a stylist.
Okay.
And my first ever song that I mean, I was an assistant to a very talented stylist by the name of Priyanjali. She was doing a song for this film, Dostana. Farah was choreographing Dostana. And she walked into set and she met me, and I was like, you know, I don't know if you remember me, but I came to you and this is what happened, and you gave me advice. And she's like, of course I remember you, and I admire your determination, because you're here, you're on a film set, you're doing what you have to do to get to where you want to be, you know, and that is what is important. You need to keep your head in the game, you need to work hard. And she's like, and she was just really happy and really sweet. And you know, when someone like that is your first interaction, or someone who is part of such a large industry, it really humbles you. You know, it really tells you that, listen, this is the way you need to behave. Like, no amount of fame, fortune, you know, good, your career, whatever it is that you get in your life, you have to be humble about it. You know, you have to give back, and you have to. You just have to be nice. Like, be a nice person. I had to do my degree because my parents were like, if this doesn't work out, you need to have something to fall back on. You need to do that. So that was really where, and the kind of thought that I came from, you know, that we can't guarantee that it's going to work, because at that time, 10, 11 years ago, makeup was not a career. Makeup, it was not like it is today. Makeup is not the industry it used to be today. So they were like, no, if it doesn't work out, you have a degree, you have all of this, you can fall back on something.
Right, right. So I think that's a great story. So I have a light-hearted question here. If you would not have been a makeup artist, what you have been doing?
I don't know, but I really don't know. But if it was up to my
Dad,
if you had, I mean, my if it answers your question, my grandmother always wanted me to be a teacher.
But I think now, go ahead.
And the thing is, like, you know, at the end of the day, I kind of feel that I am in some way a teacher, because I do have students, I do train younger makeup artists. I did, you know, I did do a bit of training and kind of, you know, learning it when I was working with Mac. So, you know, it's, I've done a lot of that, you know, and I think that I like teaching. I like walking into a room and like having my a little, like, you know, 2-3 my of my assistants or my students, whatever, you know, I like that.
Right.
I like imparting that kind of knowledge, because it's not been easy for us to learn it. We didn't have, or I didn't have, I mean, the financials to earlier on in my career to, you know, go to, like, let's say the UK or the US to go and study. So I had to make the best of what I had.
You know,
I think that I was blessed with the greatest teacher ever, who literally now runs an academy. But the time when I was learning, I was her only student. I was with her 24 hours a day. We would do film after film after film. So that kind of education, I don't think I could have gotten anywhere.
What are the critical areas and skills young artists, young makeup artists, or maybe stylists need to acquire so that they can at least have a career path?
First of all, you, if when you decide that, you know, makeup is something that I want to do, you have to be very passionate about it, because with whatever you do, forget makeup, whatever you choose to do in your life, you have to love it, you have to be passionate about it, because and now I go into the specifics of makeup. When you're a makeup artist, and you know, when an outsider looks at your career, they're like, you know what, you get to work with film stars every day, set every day, and it's all very glamorous. It's all, very beautiful from the outside. From the inside, if you are not passionate about films, if you're not passionate about makeup, if you're not passionate about being a part of the process of filmmaking and films in general, you know, you're not going to give it your 200%. and it requires your 200%. This career is not easy. You know, you have to. So that is the first thing, that you have to have passion and determination to do this and do anything in general. But I'm saying specifically.
Right.
Two is, a lot of people are self-taught. You know, there is YouTube, there are tutorials, there's everything. I have met so many talented makeup artists who just watch YouTube videos and are self-taught. So if that is something that you want to do, if that is something that, you know, you can pick up, great. You know, this industry in terms of makeup requires a lot of skill. It requires a lot of practice. It requires a lot of your time and your patience to kind of, like, you're not gonna, like, for example, you're not going to get like a winged liner correct in the first go. It's going to take practice. Your hand has to get steady. You have to have that skill of knowing which part of your eye to lift, which part of your eye, you know, to understand face shapes, to understand what, you know, hooded eyes are, to understand the technique of what should I do to open up an eye, to make an eye look bigger than it is. So yes, there is a lot of technical, there's a lot of skill which you need to learn. And all this information is available online. There are schools, there are academies, there are wonderful academies in India, there are wonderful academies outside India, you know. So the opportunity to learn is endless. The education is endless. It's just that you have to invest in yourself and try and understand what kind of artist you want to be. Because if you want to be, let's say, a celebrity artist, celebrity makeup artist, you have to be at your A game.
Yes, absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
You know, because at the end of the day, you are behind the camera, the actor is in front of the camera. So she, your work is represented on her, you know. So you have to be at your A game every single day. So that requires practice, that requires that kind of dedication. It requires, you know, that kind of, and I'm not saying you're not going to make mistakes. You're going to make mistakes, you're going to learn from them, but you have to understand how to, you know, figure out all of that, how to maneuver all of that. And that requires, again, it requires you to, you know, be part of somebody's, like get yourself a mentor, you know, like I have. I wouldn't know how to behave on set. I wouldn't know how to deal with, you know, being in a room filled, like, with an actor and a stylist and all these very talented people. How do you stand out? How do you, you know, make your point known? These little finer things are also very important, which is why we say that it is very important for you to assist. You know,
be
an assistant to a makeup artist. Understand how she does what she does, what goes into, you know, like quick tips and tricks and things that you don't learn necessarily in a school. Which is why I dedicated 6 years of my career to being an assistant, because I was like, no, I want to learn everything. I want to do. So I'm not saying that you have to dedicate 6 years. That's a choice I made. But I'm saying that you need to give it time. You're not going to be at the top of your game in a year. You know, you need
to
give it time. And you may. Let's say you're uber talented and you make it. There's nothing wrong here. But that does not mean that you don't practice or don't learn from other people. Because, you know, everyone has their different styles.
Absolutely. And how... go ahead.
So skill is, I was going to finish. Skill is very important. But along with that, there's a lot of other things that you have to understand when you're a makeup artist in this industry. And it depends whether it's bridal, editorial, you know, across the board.
So when it comes to celebrity especially, how important is the personality also? Because a lot is linked to their personality and the aura they carry in the public space. So how, and it's just a random thought that I had in my mind. So does it kind of help you as a artist in understanding them from the personality point of view and then creating something unique for them? How does this relationship work out?
I think it's very important to understand actor, no actor. Who is on your chair? At the end of the day, they are, let's say, you know, it could be a bride, it could be an actor, it could be anybody. But whenever that person sits on your chair, that person is your number one priority.
Okay.
How you make her feel, how comfortable you make her feel is up to you. Like, I can't, for example, if someone is sitting on my chair, I can't just be like, whatever, like, I'll just do one more. Whatever. No.
Right. You know, right.
I can't do that. It could be Sonam sitting on my chair. It could be one of my brides sitting on my chair. But both of those individuals are as important to me because they have chosen, we have chosen to work with each other because you like my work, you like whatever, we are working together. They believe that they can get the best out of you. If you're not going to give your best, how do you expect someone to call you back for more work?
Like, absolutely.
How do you get more work? You know, your work absolutely needs to speak for itself. Whoever's sitting on my chair, I have to be sensitive to them. If they are having a bad day, I feel like I need to be sensitive to that. You know, I need to make them feel comfortable. I need to make them feel less anxious. I need to make, you know, because then you don't want that. I mean, then you're doing makeup on them. You know, so it's very important to understand that, to know when to make a joke, to know when to like be familiar, to know when,
right,
you know what I
right
mean? Like, it's like if I was sitting on someone's chair and I'm having a bad day and my makeup artist is cracking a joke, I'll be like, listen, just relax, you know.
Absolutely.
I just need to, like, center myself. I need some peace and quiet. So you have to understand all of that. You have to understand, you know, when that person needs their space. So there's a lot that goes into when you're a makeup artist and you're working in such close proximity to another person.
And I think in your case, the most interesting part that I can see is that the human is your billboard. So you, as an artist, you don't need a billboard technically when you kind of style somebody, or when you kind of create some sort of a makeup on them, you know, when you groom them up, I think they are your billboard. So other than the word of mouth, what people see, they really buy into how good you are.
They are a representation of your work.
Absolutely.
You know, everyone thinks, oh yeah, you know, bridal makeup, it's just, you know, 2-3 hours of work, but it's 2-3 hours of really, it's really stressful because, you know, think about it. I mean, someone has reached out to you for you to be their makeup artist. It is the most important day of your life, of their life.
Right. Right. You
know, they're not absolutely going to be able to get another picture, another moment. It is what it is. So you have to deliver.
Absolutely.
You know? And you have to. And I feel that is what that thought is what really keeps everything in sort of perspective. That, you know, at the end of the day, your work needs to speak for itself. And if your work speaks for itself, you will get work. There is no way you can offer for you back. So it's not about how much, like, you know, how social you are, or like, for me, that's personally how I've handled my career. It's not about how much I go out, or how many friends I have, or how much I socialize. It's not about all of that. It's about my work.
When we're talking about people, I also want to understand from your perspective, how different or how difficult or how is it to deal with a celebrity versus a non-celebrity? So when you work with them, how different is the behavior, the aura, the entire process? Is it the same? Is it different?
You know,
share a couple of experiences.
All the girls that I have worked with, whether it's Sonam very closely, Pariniti, I've done a couple of films with her, Alia, Shraddha. You know, you tend to see them as these big stars, you know. But when we work together, when I've worked with them, you know, we've joked around, we've talked about work, we know the look, we've eaten lunch together, you know, we all sit together, we talk about, you know, our days, good days, bad days. It's pretty normal. It's not
okay.
Like, oh my God, you know, I can't talk to her, you know, I can't do this. No, they're very, you know, we're all young adults. We're all about the same age. Near far, all about the same age.
And, absolutely.
You know, and the only real difference is, and I remember talking and saying this to actually when I was talking to my sister about this one day, and I was like, you know, think about it. It's the main difference is these girls are so talented at what they do. They're in front of the camera and millions of people watching them. That is the that is the major difference. You know?
Right.
And this is my belief. Then at the end of the day, they come to work, they do their job, and we go back as us all. You know? So it's not like, you know, you have to have this this kind of aura that you were talking about. Yes, they have that. They have that aura. They work really hard. You know, they have this, you know you're in the presence of, you know, actors and things like that, but they don't make you feel like that. It's very warm. It's very friendly. You know, you feel like you all are all in it together. So I really enjoyed myself. I've been very, very lucky that way.
Give us a perspective around, you know, how much of it is an art. Do people need to understand the color theory? Do they also need to understand the chemical compositions? The because it's going to on the human skin. Do they also need to understand the compound and the chemistry? What goes behind in learning and taking it to that level of expertise?
You know, again, it's as important as knowing your skill. It's all part of the job. You know, it is your job to research products. It is your job to, as a makeup artist, you should know the shelf life of every product that you use. You should know the difference between, you know, a liquid and a cream. What kind of weather will be good for a liquid foundation? What kind of weather will be good for a cream foundation? If I'm shooting in Bombay, you know, Bombay has its, you know, because of the monsoons and the kind of weather we have, you know, maybe her skin is not liking cream. Maybe I should use a different foundation. You need to, and you need to be observant. You know, you like, I might use one foundation and it doesn't work, but I need to step it up. I need to know that in 20 minutes, I can change makeup and I can do the right thing because this is not working.
Okay.
You understand what I mean? So that comes from not only experience, it comes from how much time you devote to your research, to learning, to understanding what works in what weather, what works in what skin type, what kind of foundation. Will not all foundations are the same. Some foundations are more yellow, some foundations are more pink, you know. A lipstick, when it smells off, it means it's done, it's over, you need to get rid of it. You need to, you know, the shelf life of this brand is so much, this shelf life of this product is so much. You know, you need to understand what your hand suits. Like, some people like to use foundation with their hand, some people like to use foundation with a blender. You know, these are things that you need to, not just doing the makeup and forgetting about it doesn't work. You need to understand that, okay, I've used this foundation today. I'm in this weather today. This is how long my makeup will last. So tomorrow, if I use this foundation and this is the weather, this is how long it will last. So you have to also be very observant with what is happening and your surroundings. You know, you have to understand that different makeup suits different people. And different weather, makeup will look different. Like, I feel like sometimes when I'm doing a night shoot, makeup looks amazing. You know, like there's yellow light and you know, like stunning and skin is glowing and everything. But the same makeup in the day and you're like, in 2 hours, I need to change the makeup. You know?
Right.
So you need to understand, in how many hours does the person start looking tired? Do I need to redo the makeup? Even in editorial, even in brides, you know, brides do 2 functions a day, 3 functions a day. She's not going to last with makeup from the morning. You got to change it.
Absolutely.
At some point.
Absolutely.
So where do you find that point? What is that correct point? You don't always get 2 hours to get ready. Sometimes you need to do makeup in 20 minutes. So you need to catch whoever it is at home, mother, sister, cousin, aunt, you know. Practice. Like, I used to time myself. I used to do foundation in like an hour, and Namrata was said, dude, this is unacceptable. Like, you need to time yourself. Like, come on, it needs to go down to 20 minutes, and you got to keep doing it, you know.
Okay,
so there is a lot of skill involved. That's what I'm
right
saying. If I was not passionate about this,
right,
I would not be so enthusiastic about talking about makeup. I'll be like, whatever. You know, you need to understand, you need to invest that kind of money in buying new things, understanding new products, why is that not working, understanding new techniques, understanding what the West is doing, what are the trends coming, what are we doing in our fashion weeks, you know, things like that.
So I think what people see on the screen is just actually tip of the iceberg, because it is all about, you need to know the art, you need to know the science, it's project management, it's time management, it's color combinations, it's understanding of the weather, all combined together. I think this colors, tons of stuff.
Skin tone, it's understanding the kind of skin tone that exists not only in India, but what kind of skin tone exists in Europe. Wow. Why is it so easy? You know, with makeup artists abroad, you're like, oh, AT, it's one skin tone. There are no blemishes, you know.
Oh.
Because you can't choose who sits on your chair.
Right.
I could have the darkest under eyes. I could have pigmentation. You as a makeup artist should understand how to conceal makeup.
What are your three tips from your side that where should people go and start learning about it?
Number one would be research the kind of makeup you like. Look at magazines, look at social media, whatever it is. What kind of artist do you want to be? What are you drawn to? You know? Then, you know, try and understand if you want to assist somebody. Find a makeup artist who has that kind of approach to makeup.
Right.
You know? And most importantly is finding yourself a good academy.
Okay.
If you want to train, if you want proper skill, if you want all of that, go to a proper academy. Invest that time in yourself.
Fantastic. This line of career being so hectic from the point of view that, you know, you have, promotions happening and movie screenings happening and then press events happening, so on and so forth. How is the work-life balance for a makeup artist? How hectic it is, how critical it is.
I only now in the last 2-3 years have understood what is work-life balance. I have no idea.
Okay.
Okay. No, but I'll tell you why. Because, you know, initially when I started my career, I was like, I have to do everything. Huh? Yes. I can go home. I was born and brought up. I'm brought up in Calcutta. And so we used to go home every year in December for Christmas. And 1 year I didn't go back. My mom's like, okay, whatever. Understood that I had to work and all. The next day I was like, I'm shooting. And she's like, no, you need to come back once a year at least. That's nothing. I mean, I'm not asking you for the earth and the sky. You have to come back every December and spend time with your family. You know, and I wouldn't say I was like, okay, I'll do it. I was a bit irritated, but I also understood, and I was much younger then, but I also understood where she was coming from, because your whole life cannot become, I mean, it can, I'm just talking personally to me. I figured that my whole life cannot be just my work. I need to, if I'm working this hard, I also need to enjoy it as much.
Right.
Yes. Initially, when you're an assistant, you want to do everything, you want to be everywhere. You want to, you want to do everything.
Right.
But you soon realize that you can't say yes to everything. You're not always going to be available to everybody. So you have to let certain things go. And you have to understand that whatever comes your way is meant for you. And whatever doesn't was just not meant to. You know, you have to understand that. It took me a while to understand, because I have missed a lot of family holidays. I've missed a lot of time with my family, and you know, they've been very supportive and understood it. But if you ask me now, could I have made different decisions then? Maybe I would. You know, now knowing what I know.
Right.
But I mean, it was difficult for me initially to kind of strike that balance. But I think now that I'm older and I'm married, and you know, I understand how important it is to kind of balance it out, and balance it out to the extent that you can enjoy both, because you can have both.
Right.
I'm a huge advocate of that. You can have both. You can have a great career, and you can have a great personal life and family and all of that. You can do it. It's just finding that balance and knowing what. You know, and where to go when.
Right. But it is like a is it like a taxing job in terms of does it demand a lot of time? Is it scheduled, unscheduled? How is it like?
Being a makeup artist is very hectic. I mean, my life has been on a flight for like, let's say, out of 11 years, I think all 11 have been, you know, flying here, flying there, you know, like trying to fly from one place to another to make it to your best friend's wedding. I remember I was shooting Khoobsurat with Sonam, and my best friend in the whole wide world was getting married, and she decided to get married in Calcutta, and I was shooting.
Okay.
And I had to drive from Bikaner to Jaipur, then fly to Calcutta for 2 days, then fly back, then drive back. And then I had to do the same thing again for another best friend who was getting married in Thailand. You know, so I'm just trying to say that I did that because I wanted to be part of those precious moments. I didn't want to let go of those precious moments because they're never going to come back. And we've grown up together, you know. So these are things that, you know, you have to figure out for yourself what is important, you know, and you have to be able to make that balance.
Can you also give a few insights on what are the entry barriers to this career path?
Well, the only thing stopping you from being a makeup artist and working in this industry is not giving the importance to skill, not giving the importance to, you know, the fact that you need to give it time to learn everything. Mm-hmm. You can't learn everything in a month. You can't learn everything in a week. It's a learning process.
Okay.
You know, it's all up to you. Only, you know, if I was someone who was very laid back and I was like, I'll try, whatever, I'll figure, I'll see. It doesn't work. You got to step it up and you got to go for it. You know, go for it in the sense that if someone's giving you an opportunity, yes, you're nervous. You know, but do it. See where that takes you. You know, I was really like intimidated. I was like, oh, you know what? I'm assisting Namrata Soni. I'm really intimidated. Will she talk to me? Will she, you know, do I need to have a portfolio to be her assistant? I didn't have anything. I just went to her and I was like, I really like your work. And Sonam and I work well together. And I want to work with you because I want to be a makeup artist. And that was it.
Okay.
You know, so you don't know unless you take that chance. And not many people know this, but when I was shooting Aisha, Sonam was the one that convinced me. And she was like, you want to be a makeup artist? You want to work with Namrata? You have to go and tell her. And I was like, you know, I don't have a portfolio. I've not shot anything. I've been shooting film after film. And she's like, don't be scared. Go to her.
Wow.
Tell her this is what you want to do. Tell her you want to be an assistant. Be confident and learn. You don't know where this will take you. And I can't, you know, if it wasn't for my mind telling me to listen to her, like if I hadn't, I don't know where I'd be today. So I just took that risk and this is where I am today. So, you know, the thing is you have to step on it. You have to have that. If that person says no, for whatever reason, there will be another opportunity. There will be another opening for you. But you have to take that chance.
Wow. Any myths that you want to burst on this industry thing around makeup artists? Have you maybe some funny ones, but have you come across maybe some myths that people were like, okay, this is like that, but you're like, nahi, aisa nahi hota hai. So, do you have any myths that you want to kind of talk about?
I feel like maybe a lot of people are like, wow, you travel so much. It's so amazing. You see so many parts of the world and all people talk like this.
Okay.
And like, listen, guys, we see lots of parts of the world, but we see only the airport and we only see our hotel and we only see the location. We don't go and become tourists and like, you know, enjoy, like, you know, like I'll tell my sister, I'm flying to Paris, whatever. I'll go to Paris and I'll come back. There is no enjoying the scenery and, you know, all of this. So I think that myth that we have these amazing, like we're always on a flight and we're chilling and we're going to these places. Very rarely do we have time to stay back and actually enjoy a place. You know, there are times when there is nothing. Like, there are times when I have shot in India, shot all night, gotten onto a flight, flown to New Zealand, reached New Zealand early in the morning and shot the whole day and then
Sleep.
So it's not it's not easy. It's not like, oh, we're flying to New Zealand, amazing. No, we're flying there, we're working, and it's hectic. And, you know, yeah, sometimes, yes, we do get to enjoy the place and we do get to, you know, spend some time and make a holiday out of it. But it's very rare.
Okay. How has this industry, especially, which is such a close contact industry and which is so visual in appearance, right? How has this industry changed with time in terms of COVID?
I mean, I'm sure. See, I haven't honestly gone back to work yet because I am still taking time to. Also, I'm spending time at home. I'm with my husband. So for me, you know, I'm in a very different place right now. You know, I got married this year in January and we've been in lockdown.
Okay.
You know, so that's been, and, you know, they initially, I was very stressed out because I went back to work immediately. And so did my husband. And we both went back to work and I was traveling nonstop till like March. And then, you know, suddenly COVID hit and I didn't know what to do. I was like, what happens to my job and what happens to makeup and what happens to me and my shoots and da, 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 da. And then, you know, things just keep growing in your head. And then you realize that, I mean, for me personally, I sat down and I realized that this is finally time where I get to, like I said, I get to generate content. I get to see and understand the wonders of social media, of the kind of reach we have online. So, you know, it's a different side of makeup, but it doesn't necessarily mean that my makeup has stopped or, you know, I'm not in touch with it. But I also get to enjoy this time, which if you ask me, I would have never taken 7 months off to enjoy, you know, being
married,
you know, things like that. I have that problem. Like, I can't say I need to be on shoot or whatever. But I'm just trying to draw the positive from it, and I think that this time has really been wonderful for me in terms of what has happened to the industry. I think things have changed drastically. I think that now we have to view, because we work in such close proximity to people, we have to be that much safer. We have to
absolutely
be that much more cautious. You know, we cannot carry makeup artists, I mean, me and some other colleagues of mine, we tend to carry everything we have because pata chale, you know, you don't know what you want. You carry all your eyeshadows, but now we have to understand to carry smaller kits. We have to sanitize those kits. We can't have, you know, we can't be carrying all of this makeup because you have to sanitize all of that. You have to think about not only yourself and your client. You have to wear a mask. You have to, you know, be cautious when you travel. You can't do. We tend to do one thing after another, fly from one city to another city to another city. You can't do things like that. So it does change planning. Planning your month, planning your dates, planning your films, planning bridal, anything, any kind of shoot, any kind of commitment, you have to plan. You know, there's a lot of planning now, of course, because there's a lot of safety issues that are coming in. So, and then also it's a personal thing. You have to know when, if you want to go back to work, if you want to fly, if you want to travel. So I think people are just trying to make the best of it. And yes, it has changed. It has changed the industry. It has changed it in a huge way. But I think that we're trying to make the best of it. And we're trying to understand where and what we can change in order to get some sort of that, you know, old kind of work back.
What are the more opportunities beyond makeup? And also, what are the more collaboration opportunities beyond the conventional makeup thing that you see are a part of the career line of a makeup artist? Because you have been doing a lot of collabs.
All of us now are creating digital content. All of us now, we shoot at home. We shoot ourselves. We shoot on an iPhone. We then send it to an editor. An editor sits and edits it. You know, you send the footage back and you release it. It's not, you realize that you don't actually have to be in such close proximity right now. So that is an avenue to be a blogger, to understand, you know, to kind of understand the industry, understand products, understand, you can be a blogger in anything, you know, anything that you're interested in, you can talk about, you can have discussions. So that's one avenue that you can look into. See, not to say that we're not going to go, I mean, there are shoots happening, there is work happening in Bombay.
Yes.
Everyone's being super safe, everyone's being very cautious. Like I said, you know, things are getting very, very tiny steps. But it's like, you know, I'm not sitting and, yes, do I want to be on set? Do I want to be in that van with like my friends and my colleagues and back to shooting? Yes, I do. I love it. It's one of the reasons why I do what I do. But I'm not letting these days pass by just sitting around and hoping that one day that will happen. You know, there are other things you can do with makeup. You can do makeup on yourself. You can can show people how you can do makeup on yourself with just the small kit that you have. You can take, you can bring your cousin and do, you know, makeup on her and make a makeup video. Somebody will see it. Some makeup brand will see it and they'll be like, you know what? We really like her. We really like how she looks on camera.
Wow.
We like her videos. Let's give her makeup and let her do something about it. So you don't know where that content will reach. You don't know where that content is being seen by how many people. That is the beauty of social media and the kind of advantage we have now. I didn't have this advantage when I started my career. So I had to go from shoot to shoot to shoot, you know. But today you have this avenue. There are such amazing, amazing makeup artists, you know, in the West, in India, who are not makeup artists who do makeup for films or editorials. They just create content and they are so good. They are so good. I learn from them. I watch their videos, you know. I watch bloggers like Shireen and Masoom and all of these girls, you know. I mean, they do their own makeup and they do a spectacular job. You know, so I mean, the opportunities are endless. You just have to find them.
Did the brands like Miss Malini and all of these approach you, or is it the other way around? And if you want to do that, how can one approach these brands and do a collab?
Initially, okay, let me tell you. Initially, I put out content into on social media, and they got in touch with me.
Okay.
And you have to understand that not. I mean, makeup artists today have to understand that not everything is about money. You can't be motivated by... You can be motivated. Yes, you can be motivated by money, but not everything is about money.
Absolutely.
You know, all of these things, like working with Miss Malini, I wanted to. I like her website. I like her. I like the kind of content she generates. I want to be a part of that. They are coming to me. I'm not going to be like, no, I don't want to do it because I'm not being paid. No, I'm not like that. For me personally, if I like doing the collaboration, I'll do it. You know, because I know in the long run, the kind of viewership she has, that content can go anywhere. Now, I didn't know that you Googled it and you found, you know, when you do RT9, whatever, you Google it and you found that video. I didn't.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Also, absolutely. Yeah.
There's somebody who's like, how do I clean my makeup brushes? That video is going to pop up because that's the only video that they have. You know?
Right.
So,
right.
You know, you have to understand what that collaboration is doing for you. You know, I also love working with that team because I know Natasha, the beauty editor, really well. And we've worked together for years. And, you know, we just thought of an idea. And I was like, dude, do you think that this is good to do? Do you want to do this with me? And she's like, yeah, of course. And it just happened organically. So, you have to just, you know, find those moments. And I mean, I had an idea. I gave it to her and she was happy to do it. And we did it together and it's great. So a lot of the collaboration that I have done have come to me like that. Like I just approached them and I'm like, I really like your brand. I would love to do something with it. Are you okay? Like, do you want to do it? And they're like, yeah, of course, we're happy to. 10 years ago, I couldn't have, for example... I couldn't, like, let's say any brand, let's pick Armani, whatever, any brand, Armani, right? 10 years ago, I couldn't have gone online and messaged them on their makeup page, been like, I am so-and-so, I would like to collaborate with you, are you okay with that? Forget whether they say yes, forget whether they say no. I didn't have that opportunity 10 years ago. Today, on social media, you literally can talk to the person in charge of the beauty division in any company, you know, and you can be like, this is who I am, this is my content. If you feel like, and I'm not talking about, okay, forget Armani, any brand, like even Nykaa, this is my content, this is the kind of shoots I do, I'm an aspiring makeup artist. I'm super passionate about it. Will you do a collab with me? They could say yes, they could say no. But see how easy it is to email. See how easy it is to get in touch with these people.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think social media has definitely increased the horizon of opportunities that people have. And I think a lot can be, done now. Yeah. What's been your family relationship be like? Of course, you have spoken about and given the example of your mother, right? But what's been your relation with your family? And maybe any advice for young adults or people watching this show who now want to get into an unconventional space, but may or may not get support from your family. What's your advice or tips on that?
Firstly, I want to say that I don't think I could have done this without the support of my family. I think they have had to endure a lot of me not being around for many things because I wanted to, go after my career. I have to say that it also comes from a space where my mom was very career-driven. You know, she knew the importance of having a career, of doing something that you're really, really passionate about. So that is something that she really, both my parents were of the view that me and my sister should do things that we love to do, number one. And number two is, you can never say, I keep laughing to her about it because she keeps saying this, but she's like, you can never say I can't,
Right.
And I'm like, Ma, I'm always laughing at her. But there is some method to her, madness, as I call it, that there is, and I'm exactly like her, as much as I might want to say otherwise, I'm exactly like her when it comes to my career. Like, I'm always like, I got to do this, and she has never said to me, I don't think you should do this. I think that you should, come for this holiday or whatever. Like, she's never said that, she's always been very understanding. So, even my sister, everyone, so for me, it's been, without them, I don't think I would have achieved as much as I have achieved. But also it comes from a space where she understands that, I raised a very responsible human being, and I know that he's living in Bombay alone, but I have to trust her. And I have to let her go and kind of figure out her own path. And that way I was very lucky. But I also understand at the same time, not everyone has the same opportunity that I have. Not everybody has the same kind of understanding from family. And I've met young girls who say that, I can do makeup, but I need to be home by 10 o'clock. But their passion truly lies in shooting films. And in shooting films, you can never say, I'm going home at 10 o'clock.
Absolutely.
If they really want to do this, they have to kind of explain to their parents that this is what I want to do. They have to show them that this is a career that is, it's, you can have a great career, you can earn great money, you can have great experiences. You have to sit down and explain to them, because I don't think everyone or all parents actually can grasp that idea, that makeup or being a makeup artist is a career in itself.
Exactly. Absolutely.
I think that, and I tell this to a lot of young girls, boys, whoever I've met who want to be makeup artists, I said, you have to explain to them that this is the career. These are the kind of people who are makeup artists today. These are mentors. These are people who've had full-fledged careers and are famous. Look at Mickey Contractor. Look at Namrata. Look at Puneet. Look at all these young men, whoever, there's Sonic from Mac, there's all of these young women, Clint Fernandez, all of them that have just literally had these like amazing, amazing careers, are famous in their own, in fashion, in film, celebrity, whatever, writing, anything.
Absolutely.
So it is a full-fledged career, and I think that if they don't understand, I think we need to make them understand.
Give us a few stories, a few insights, maybe something around how did you deal with failures, what failures you had, and what did you learn out of them? So what's been your relationship with failure and learnings around that?
I've had my moments where I really like, I think when I, there was a time when I took a break from films, and for a year and a half, and I went and worked at MAC, at Shoppers Stop, on the shop floor, to kind of understand that aspect of makeup. Because I was like, what if I don't like films? What if I actually don't want to be in films? I actually want to work in a company. And then I went to the company, and then I was like, no, but I feel like I want to be in films. And then, you know, Sonam was doing a film called Bevakoofi, and Namrata needed an assistant. And I was like, I'll come. I'm ready. You know, I've gone, and that is one of the reasons why I feel Namrata as a mentor had kind of encouraged me to break away from her, because it was very, it was that time where I could have gotten attached and very, what is the word? I could have got very comfortable with her being around and me not really being the person in charge and kind of being confident in my own talent. I think breaking away, doing my own thing, you know, working with different people every day gave me that confidence.
Right.
And when I came back and I joined her, there was a day when she was not there and I was doing makeup and I had never been on a set by myself. And I had to do Sonam's makeup. And I was like, oh God, now what? Like, am I putting the right thing? Am I putting the right thing? Did I do the blush properly? Did I do the hair properly? You know, and then I went very like scared to the director. I was like, is this okay? Is that okay? And she was like, okay, this is not right. That is not right. This is not right. And at that point, you know, you think, I mean, I thought that, oh my God, what am I going to do? Like, you know, I don't know any of this. Like, it's wrong and I failed and I'm not a makeup artist. And you just need to calm yourself. All the information is here, you know. You just have to be calm and there is a solution. You cannot, and I've made my mistakes. Like, I had to correct my mistake in 20 minutes and I had to tell Sonam, I made a mistake and I need to correct it. And she looked at me and she's like, okay, correct. Do you think it will look better? I said, yeah, it will look better. And she and I think that that comes from a space where, I mean, at that point I realized that, you know, this is a relationship that I feel like I'm very lucky, because she understands also where I'm coming from, that I want to do my best for her. There's days when I've lost things of Namrita's as an assistant and I'm like, I'm very sorry I lost it. So I've made my mistakes and I've learned from it.
Okay.
So it just, you have to learn from them. It's part and parcel of every,
Absolutely. So now I want to get into some kind of very casual, rapid fire conversation with you. And of course I have got
very serious things you've asked me.
Yes, because then I have a few questions from the audience as well, and there are a couple of very interesting questions. How big is a makeup kit?
Huge.
That huge. How huge?
I can tell you in terms of kgs.
Yes, that's, tell me kgs.
Mine is between 35 and 40.
Kgs?
Yeah.
Wow, that's big.
I'm telling you the truth.
Okay, so how do you carry it then if it's 30-35 kgs? Stuff.
And that's everything. Then that will get into a smaller kit depending on where I'm going. But if I'm shooting with an actor or if I'm shooting like a film, then I carry everything. So then I carry 35 kilos. What to do?
So your kit is 35 kgs. That's like, I think, big. Do you had any celebrity fan moment?
I've had two in my life. Number Go ahead, one please. Was the first time I met Shah Rukh. And the fact that he was so nice and so sweet and remembered my name through the entire process and also like cracked a few jokes and trusted me completely, I think, because I was an assistant then and Namrata, and I was working with her and we were trying to juggle 2-3 things and I had to go with him and make sure he shot some like makeup wise. And he was very sweet and I was not nervous. He was very humble. So that was a big fan moment.
Okay.
And second would be when I went to Cannes for the film festival.
Wow.
And I met Jane Fonda. I died.
Who you met? Who? Sorry.
Jane Fonda.
Okay.
And I died. I think she's an amazing, fabulous woman, and for her age, I mean, she is an inspiration.
Your favorite makeup look?
My favorite makeup look.
What does what do you like?
For me, the no makeup, really nude makeup, which is maybe a liner, just accentuating your features very subtly, but also makes it look very out there. I think mm-hmm. that would be my favorite kind of makeup, like nude-ish, okay. glowy skin. For me, skin is very important. For me, skin is okay. number one. So, yeah.
Okay. So now I have a couple of questions from the audience side, and I think a few of them are very exciting. Let me start with them and then we'll quickly do a wrap. What, in your opinion, is the most important quality of a makeup artist?
The most important qualities, AB, are passion, determination, mm-hmm. and hard work.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Who are your favorite makeup gurus?
My mentor is my favorite, Namrata. Nikki sir, I really love, there's a international makeup artist called Pat McGrath who I really love. I love watching and learning from her.
Do you do FX prosthetics too? What extra skills are required for that?
I mean, for prosthetics, you have to go to a school.
Okay.
I did pick up a little bit from when I was in my assistant days. But I haven't mm-hmm. done a professional course in prosthetics. But I know that Delima Academy in the UK is amazing for that course. They have a really, really good prosthetic course.
Okay. What is the difference between applying makeup for a TV shoot and applying makeup for a live appearance party?
I mean, it depends. When you're doing a TV shoot, the makeup has to last like for 12 to 14 hours because you're shooting the entire day. You have okay. to touch up accordingly. For a photo for an event, you have to understand what you're wearing. You can go slightly more glamorous for your thing. You can be a little more avant-garde with your makeup. You can go slightly mellow on your makeup. It depends. You can you can do whatever makeup you want depending on the event. So you know, you can do like make it extra glamorous, do extra highlighter, for example. So it just depends.
Are you planning to launch your own line of cosmetics? Nowadays, many celebrities and celebrity MUA are doing that.
I am planning to launch my own collection. I've also taken this time where I've been at home and, you know, had the time to do the research and things like that. So I am planning to do that. But whenever it is, I hope that you guys support me and come out and, you know, pick makeup from my collection.
So with this, we wrap. So first of all, thank you so much for giving us your time, Aarti. It was lovely talking and chatting with you.